Hello, I'm V.B. Price. I'm the editor of New Mexico Mercury. I'm here today in the Mercury Library with old friend E.A. Toni Morris, a poet, author, translator, historian, essayist, teacher, a man of many, many trades, all of them wonderful. He's also one of the co-authors of a groundbreaking book entitled Resolana, Emerging Chicano Dialogues on Community and Globalization. Toni's many other works include With the Eyes of a Raptor, translations of Spanish poet Angel Gonzalez, and a current book of poems in progress, or I guess done now, on the Spanish Civil War and the death of Garcia Lorca. It's great to have you with us, Toni.
Glad to be here, Barrett.
So our conversation today, Toni, as we've discussed, is couched in the context of a political and social world bitterly divided along class and ethnic lines, a world in which political conversation is reduced to the barbs of propaganda, and the information media is in a major time of upheaval. We're going to move today from a discussion of Resolana as a process of respectful conversation problem solving to the media revolution in New Mexico that occurred when Padre Martinez began operating the first printing press in our state in the late 1830s, and all the lessons that to be learned from that event. Could you begin by telling us a little bit about what the essence of Resolana is?
I'd be happy to, Barrett. The process known as Resolana was really the brainchild of a wonderful, highly respected, and I think brilliant thinker, a man by the name of Tomás Atencio. Tomás Atencio developed the idea of Resolana, Resolana meaning the place where the sun shines on a south-facing wall. And it refers to the place, in the metaphor that Tomás Atencio used, it refers to the place where people gather to gossip, to exchange information. And it was the place where ideas could be formulated about the community, about where it was going. And so Tomás took a custom from his experiences in the villages of northern New Mexico where he was raised, and he used that concept as a metaphor for community development. And the idea of Resolana basically is that if you have a gathering of community people and they examine issues that are relevant to themselves, you will get an analysis that is worthwhile for community development. Community development from the bottom up, from the community itself, the input from the community rather than some kind of an administrative superstructure.
Tomás Atencio conceived of this idea. Could you give us a little historical background as to when that happened and the kind of influence he's had?
As a young man, Tomás Atencio, who had been born and raised in northern New Mexico, in Dixon, New Mexico, as a young man, he served in the U.S. Army in Korea. And when he returned from Korea, he eventually took advanced degrees in social work. But even though he had formal training in social work, at heart, Tomás Atencio was really a philosopher. And he was able to apply his philosophical concepts to his own background in northern New Mexico. He was aware of the Greek academia, the Greek scholars meeting to discuss important issues. And he said, you know, hey, that's kind of what happens in a village when we gather in the Resolana to discuss issues. And he used that concept as a metaphor and as an organizing principle to attract, to build a nucleus of community persons who were interested in their villages, in their agricultural enterprises, and who could address the political, social, and economic issues that arose in those villages, particularly and most significantly, I think, people who were Resolaneros, people who took part in La Resolana, were and are concerned about the ongoing impact of the Industrial Revolution on local communities. You know, we sometimes forget that the way we live today is not the normal way that human beings live. The Industrial Revolution is only, what, 2, maybe 3 centuries old at the most? And in all of the time period prior to the mid to late 18th century, human beings lived on farms or whatever they were called, but it was a rural existence. There were villages, there were small towns, but the factory system didn't exist. Yes. And the Industrial Revolution called into existence a whole new way of concentrating us as human beings in surroundings that are totally new to us. As a matter of fact, what I've noticed since I live in downtown Albuquerque, many people complain about the problem of pigeons. Well, I love the pigeons because they are a constant reminder that in our efforts to rebuild, to build cities, we have accidentally created cliffs. And the pigeons are another name for a pigeon is a rock dove. They are little creatures who dwell in cliffs. And so all over downtown Albuquerque, at sunrise or at sunset, you will see these little critters lined up on the edges of the cliffs, or their cliffs, the buildings. They probably think that we're serving, that we're their servants, that we're building cliffs for them where they didn't exist before, you know. Well, anyway, I just use that as an example of how radically we have altered the landscape, how radically we have altered the way we live in the early 21st century. And I think Resolana really does address some of those issues. It is a work that has not received widespread recognition. As far as I know, it isn't even used as a textbook wow. anywhere. But I think it's got a lot to say. In particular, the essay by, the book is organized in 3 essays. And the first essay by Tomás Atencio really addresses the core issues of how he came to develop the concept of La Resolana. And among the many interesting things he says in that first essay, for example, he recalls conversations with his uncle, Eliseo, who has decided to live more as a 19th century or 17th century person with no electricity, no running water, etc. And when Tomás informs him that he's going to do some planting, Eliseo asks him, well, where are you getting the seeds? And Tomás says, I've got the seeds in an old lard bucket that my dad left many years ago. And Eliseo says, good, that's a good thing because those are old seeds. Those are good seeds for here. Do not use the seeds from Las Cruces, the biologically altered seeds.
Oh.
He said, if the climate's going to change, imagine in the 1960s, he said, the climate is going to change and the old seeds up here will do better. They're acclimated here. And by gosh, he was right. Apparently, the genetically engineered seeds are fragile.
So here we are hearing about rock doves and old seeds, and in the context of Resolana, which sort of seems to me to be leading us to the thought that there is very serious, realistic, actual application of the principles of Resolana in a globalized environment such as our own.
The first chapter of Resolana develops Tomás Atencio's ideas. The second chapter shows a practical application. The second chapter is an essay by the scholar Miguel Montiel. And Miguel Montiel used Resolana as a model to develop a series of interviews in Arizona. And he contacted a number of people who he interviewed them, and they discussed their life experiences and how their life experience had helped them become teachers and doctors and various other professionals, professional categories they had entered in their lives. The third chapter is the one I put together, and it deals with a concept that I think is deeply embedded in the concept of Resolana, and that is the concept that through communication, through communication, you can break down barriers between people. You can find out what the real issues are that concern them, and you can do this in our own day and age by an adaptation of Resolana to make the leap from the village place where the sun hits the Resolana to the new Resolana, the internet, that connects all of us on a global scale. And basically what I did in that chapter is discuss the mathematical theory of graph theory. That is the theory developed by the mathematician Euler in the 19th century, the theory that postulates that there are nodes that are held together by links. And for example, a bridge is a link between two villages, let us say. And what Euler discovered in his initial development of graph theory is that a graph has mathematical characteristics of its own that determine what can be done with a graph. So, for example, in his study of a village, and I can't recall off the top of my head where the village was, but he developed the idea that in order to get to various nodes near this village, you had to use the bridges, the links, in a certain way. And you couldn't use them in any other way because that was the nature of the link of the linkages. Uh-huh. So applying that to today's world, the internet provides certain ways of linking people so that they can communicate about their needs, and that's the basic concept. And of course, you can extend that. Another finding by Euler is that when you have a large enough cluster, you have a large node, then when the links within, say, persons living in a village, when the links become one-to-one, suddenly a new community arises. You go through a phase transition. Nice. And I think we are in the process of going through several simultaneous phase transitions in terms of communication at the local, the regional, the national, whatever that is, and the international level. That's the thrust of my essay on Resolana. And I go into some detail disagreeing with certain authors. I won't go into that right now. But basically, what I am saying is I think, you know, all technology has a downside, of course, but I think one of the promises of the new technology is that it will make us on a global scale less strangers to each other. And if we get to know each other better, I think and I hope this will eventually, not right away, but eventually dramatically decrease the possibilities of human conflict, particularly war.
So I know that you're intensely interested in the life and work of Padre Martinez, and you've done Chautauqua performances about him. You know a great deal about him. I've always been interested in him, too, as a newspaper person, because I know he began something that I've long admired in northern New Mexico, which was its long history of many, many, many local Spanish-language newspapers all over the north. I also have been sort of, now as we're talking about Resolana and about this move from the village, the sunny wall to the internet. It seems that the good father made a similar move a long time ago. He brought something, a very newfangled idea, into northern New Mexico and started to publish all kinds of things, tracts and religious documents and other things, but also I believe small newspapers as well. And so I'm wondering if there's a sort of a link between all of this, and this wonderful, good padre.
I'd be delighted to show the connection between Padre Antonio Jose Martinez and his time and our time today. And I think, since you mentioned newspapers, that's a very good place to begin. I think Padre Martinez, who of course was born in 1793, and he died in 1867. So of course, he lived in a time prior to all the technological advances of the late 19th and 20th century. However, Padre Martinez had a vision of the villages where he lived, in the midst of which he dwelled in northern New Mexico, of being able to work together in peace and in harmony. And I think towards that end, he founded the first significant newspaper in the state, El Crepúsculo, The Dawn, El Crepúsculo de la Libertad, The Dawn of Liberty, the full name of it. He also started the first, major school in the area, and it was a male-female school, co-educational. It was a co-educational school, which was unusual for that time. And I think Padre Martinez, and I say this based on having read his work and read about him, I think Padre Martinez saw in education and in newspaper work the means of developing links between the nodes. The nodes were the people, the individual students, the parishioners, linking them together for their own personal good and for the communal good. He had a very strong sense of community. And I'm glad that there has been, I'm happy I should say, that there has been a revival, or something of a revival, of interest in Padre Martinez, because I think what he did is still a good example of how an individual can impact a community in a positive way, helping it to become aware of itself and of its own potential for development.
So those of us who've read Death Come to the Archbishop and other books about that era know that that the good padre was cast in a rather dubious light, but in reality, despite his long battles with Archbishop Lamy and other, he really was the great sort of spark that that turned, that catalyzed an already enormously cosmopolitan area with all kinds of contacts all over the Mountain West, trading contacts and even literary contacts, I think, into something explosively wonderful and in print. And I'm always been interested in him, and I'm just going to jump on you now and ask you to tell us more about the discrepancy between his bad image and his reality.
As you know, Barrett, Padre Martinez lived in a time the time that still extends to today, in terms of the United States being a very puritanical society. And there was a very puritanical regard to sexual morality that is still predominant in parts of the United States. And that puritanism was not characteristic of Catholicism in Europe, nor in Mexico. In fact, I heard an Englishman once say that we got rid of our Puritans. We sent them to the U.S., you know, so we got stuck with them. But in any case, Padre Martinez was frowned upon by many North Americans because he had a long-standing mistress. Let me explain something. First of all, to begin with, Padre Martinez did not intentionally set out to become a priest. He thought he was going to work with his father in the ranching and trading business that his father had established, and that had extensive contacts down the old Santa Fe Trail, El Camino Real, extending into Mexico, and then extending east across the plains to the buffalo lands. Padre Martinez was very much aware of the context of the Southwest in terms of it being part of a much larger world. But as I say, as a young man, he'd intended to follow into his father's business, and he married. He married when he was about 18 or 19 years of age. He and his wife had a child. The mother died during childbirth. And so he was left as a very young widower. And he thought he had better be able to provide a way of supporting this this child, his daughter. And he, after much speculation, he decided to go to Mexico, study for the priesthood, leave his daughter with his parents, which is a very common practice, and to return, and as a priest, he would be able to provide for his daughter and welfare. Well, shortly after he returned from Mexico, his daughter at age 12 passed away.
Oh.
So here he was, a priest. His daughter had passed away. And I think in part as a reaction to all that, he threw himself into a frenzy of work. He, as you know, brought in a press and used it. He opened schools. He tried to alert the communities of northern New Mexico to their social needs. And so, you know, the he did, it is true, he did have a mistress, which was common practice in many, many Catholic villages throughout the world, probably still is common practice for all I know. And he cared for her. He was a good husband. They had possibly a couple of children. I have a cousin who claims direct descent from Padre Martinez. I'm a little doubtful of that, but maybe he is a descendant of Padre Martinez. So what? Who cares? Who cares, you know? I think it's preposterous to try to juxtapose the good that a man has done to his personal qualities, even his personal foibles. He was not a criminal. He didn't harm anyone. And who of us could really stand up under a strong light searching all of our the hidden quarters, corners of our past lives. Very few. Very few would be left standing in such a strong searchlight. And so, again, I'm very pleased, for example, that there is a very good statue of Padre Martinez in the Taos Plaza right now. And I think it was high time that Taos honor a person who I think is and was its foremost citizen.
So here we have a human being, a really towering human being, who, in a certain sense, in his activities and in his devotion to education and in his embracing of new technology, in a context in which Resolana already existed, probably for many, many hundreds of years before. He seems to me to be a kind of a link between the networking possible on the internet and the intimate networking of a Resolana community. And here is this man, a New Mexican, a pioneer in intellectual dissemination and long distance discussion, if you will, through print media. And I'm just I think it's wonderful to have that person at the roots of our cultural life in New Mexico.
I think Padre Martinez was a true visionary. Now, full disclosure here, Padre Martinez was my great-great-uncle. Full disclosure. But even if I weren't related to him at all, I don't think it makes any difference. He was a stellar figure in his own right. And he indeed, I think, was a link from his time to ours, in the sense that he saw the need for communication devices. In this case, it was a newspaper because of the times in which he lived. A newspaper and the school where children and young people could be taught directly. Padre Martinez trained many priests, for example. He trained many nuns who went on to serve in the church. And he also reached out to communities with his newspaper work. Now, as you know, as all readers of Will of Cather know, Archbishop Jean-Baptiste Lamy, who I don't think was at all the saintly figure she portrays him to be, in some ways he was a rather harsh man, but I'm not going to go there. I think that Lamy, who was very much a European, including, I think, Lamy carried with him all the vices of Europeans. He really thought Western civilization was superior to the beliefs of indigenous people. He once made a reference to his poor Mexicans. He said, alas, we can never bring them up to our standards, you know. And I think when he encountered Padre Martinez, he was encountering a living, breathing embodiment of everything he abhorred. That is, here was a person who was of the wrong ancestry, the wrong ethnic background, and he was publishing newspapers, and he was educating, and he did it without any necessary approval from Rome, thank you. He did it on his own. And he also founded another communication network called the Penitential Brotherhood. The Holy Brotherhood, the Holy Brotherhood of our Lord Jesus Christ is what it's called in Spanish. La Santa Hermandad de Nuestro Padre Jesús Nazareno, the Holy Brotherhood of our Father Jesus Christ the Nazarene, popularly referred to as the Penitentes because of the penitential self-flagellation of the rites. Now, these penitential rites were vastly exaggerated by reporters for Harper's Magazine and other such venues when they came west. And it forced the Brotherhood to withdraw, to become secretive. They weren't secretive before the coming of Archbishop Lamy and Easterners. But, you know, the founding of this Brotherhood was a red line for Bishop Lamy, I believe, because the Catholic Church, like all institutions, has a hierarchy, and they try to control the flow of events through that hierarchy. I think the church, for example, has always been suspicious of saints who go around the hierarchy, who have visions of God. Whoa, you know, without our permission, you're having visions, you know. Well, the Padre Martinez had done something like that. He had organized a brotherhood out technically without any permission from Rome. And Lamy moved quickly to try to incorporate it into the church, and he was not opposed by Padre Martinez in doing that. But Padre Martinez was a constant thorn in Bishop Lamy's side. And that would be a whole other interview, I think, on Bishop Lamy. But I think what we're concentrating on here is the fact that Padre Martinez did use the technology of his day and age to open up communications, to link diverse and disparate peoples together for positive goals, for positive reasons, for constructive goals. And for that, I think we should all be grateful. And furthermore, he was a New Mexican. You know, we did it here all on our own.
So in a way, Tomas Atencio and yourself are the heirs of Padre Martinez, who took the concept of Resolana. I don't know if he actually used that word or not, but brought it into the modern age with him, and with the contraption of the printing press, which changed everything. And in a sense, he's our heir too. Benito Aragon and I are, we're doing the Mercury. We're trying to link everybody together in a certain sense, in a useful and interesting way that will stimulate a social good. I think the internet is working in that direction. Although I wish we had a sunny wall that we could lean against. So, where do you think we're going here? Are we do we have a chance to do something constructive?
I think Padre Martinez and Resolana have many heirs. I think Tomás Atencio, and at a later date myself, I had the great privilege of working with Tomás and the great privilege of working on the Resolana project. But the Resolana, we are all heirs to La Resolana. It belongs to all of us. And I think it belongs to all those involved with New Mexico Mercury. Because this is an extension in time of a very old concept, and that is that it is through conversation, through getting to know each other, that you can resolve difficulties. It becomes very easy to demonize someone you've actually broken bread with, or that you've had extensive communications with. And I think there, the internet has its own problems. I'm well aware of that. But the internet can be seen, I think, in under good circumstances, under the best of circumstances, the internet is used as that kind of a communication device to lessen or decrease tensions between people, to make it easier to communicate face-to-face. I would have loved it, for example, if during... When Nazi Germany was on the verge of the Holocaust, if there had been a reporter there with a microphone saying to Adolf Hitler, "What do you intend to do, Mr. Chancellor? You're the head of the German government. All the world is watching you. What do you intend to do?" Would it have made any difference? Maybe not. Maybe not. But who knows? We'll never know, of course. But I think there's more pressure on public officials now to try to communicate, to try to keep channels open with their own people. Even dictators try to make themselves look good, And maybe that's a step forward, in a sense.
Well, this has been just a wonderful conversation. Thank you so very much for being with us today. And I think I'm inspired by being in this same ground where so much wonderful work has been done in the past. And let's hope all of us can continue to do it in the future.
I'll just say it's been a pleasure to be interviewed by you, Barrett, and by New Mexico Mercury. I think the work you are doing and New Mexico Mercury is a logical and, more important, a humane extension of the kind of work that Resolana envisions, an extension of the kind of work that goes all the way back to Padre Martinez and beyond into earlier generations. But now that we've made the leap from an industrial society to the beginnings of a post-industrial society, I think we have to make the communication leap from an older type of technology to the new technology. And I think it is up to us to keep those communication channels open, to make sure that the internet becomes a democratic and remains a democratic institution, and that it does not become the hunting ground for those who would spy on us at all times.